Hello, I'm Nick Pryke and you're watching Meet the Boss TV. In this episode, why all eyes are on Africa when it comes to unveiling the next generation of mCommerce. From contactless payments to augmented reality, the potential power of the mobile device is only just being harnessed. And while consumers wait for the next Angry Birds to unveil itself, behind the scenes, there's a new and far greater ecosystem being built. I spoke with Lars Arvidsson, VP and Head of Sales for mCommerce over at Ericsson, to find out more, starting with how he sees the mobile landscape changing.
If we look into the developed market, I think a couple of things that definitely is picking up quickly is the adaptation of smart devices. With that, of course, you see also more and more intelligent services will be provided. Regulations is also moving actually pretty quickly as well, because regulatory bodies, governments, etc. see the benefits, both business and from a consumer perspective, actually to carry out new kind of services. You see new players coming in like operators, you see retailers as well, more and more big brands in all different kind of industries is joining. Of course, that gives both business and the consumers more choices and better services.
So specifically to African then, what would you say are some of the more notable differences or opportunities specific to Africa when you compare that to, let's say, the BRIC markets?
Particularly in Africa, I mean, we did this mobile money, mobile financial services launched for close to 10 years ago now, or 7 or 8 years ago. It's actually the people, both the individual, the consumer, the household, but also business, because it's very much small businesses actually, is picking up quickly. So you see entrepreneurship, you see trading between people and small businesses is improving significantly. Compare that to the more advanced market or semi-advanced market, of course, you have other kind of infrastructure and in place already that didn't exist. But with the thanks to the qualities as a first kind of a solution, at least you could actually start to see the benefits from that perspective.
And while perspective is important, so too is the need for clarity, especially when it comes to the emerging markets. I asked Lars how Ericsson defines mCommerce, and more importantly, what separates the first and second generations as the journey continues.
Ericsson is a big believer in mCommerce, generally speaking. We believe we are still in an early phase of this. We define as a second generation of mCommerce very much because whatever is out there is the first generation. What we have learned and the feedback in different forums from customers, from consumers, is actually that there's a belief, there's a need actually that this should be adopted and will be seen as a mass market. And in order to do that, of course, you can see in other industries driving mass markets, like in the telecom industry. So you see the standardization, for example, you must have reliable systems out there, you must have systems that can talk to each other, and you must secure that they have consistency. And in order to drive that, of course, you need to have big players in the ecosystem, and it's a very broad ecosystem. There's banks, there's credit cards, there's telecom companies, content providers, etc., etc. All of them, of course, need to have some common view and common theme. So I think we see it's going in that direction. So there is standardizations in certain areas ongoing.
Okay, so you mentioned there about banks, financials, telco operators, and this very complex dynamic of the mCommerce ecosystem then. What would you consider to be the biggest challenges specifically for banks and telco operators when looking at connecting up to the mCommerce ecosystem?
It's a very, very good question, and we have, for example, facilitated quite many sessions around the world, roundtable discussions together with banks and operators and even regulators in the same room at the same time. And that's very interesting because you can see definitely a lot of call it commonalities. Both entities see the same opportunity, to some extent they see a little bit the same challenges, but sometimes of course they are competitors. and sometimes they need to partner. So it's hard to say. I think important will be, because if you take this from a national perspective, in more or less any country in the world, they are in the same country. They're keen to develop their business, of course, in that particular country. I think regulations once again come into space to ensure that actually there is enough of room and the conditions in the marketplace actually to create and make good business for the society and for the country. So yes, there is differences, that's for sure. Operators have benefits. They also they have control of the consumers, like the mobile consumers. So they know where they are. They have a dialogue. They have them as a customers for many other services, whatever they do. Banks, yes, of course, depending in markets, in more advanced markets, more or less all of us have a bank account. But if you go to many markets, particularly in the emerging market, they don't have bank accounts. So there is no real relations between, call it, the potential consumer and the bank, even if they would like to move there. The entire value chain in a country and the ecosystem in a country, I think it's something that is important actually to create that local ecosystems based on the condition that exists in the country. And there is no single play.
So is there an argument in that sense, Lars, to say that in some ways there's even more opportunity in emerging markets because you're starting with a cleaner slate than you would be in the more developed markets?
Yes, I think it's maybe there's more higher degree of need in emerging markets to carry out, call it, the basic services. Why shouldn't they have basic financial services as well? So of course, I think that's part of the well care and the health, and actually how do we evolve in the society with the basic needs. So far, I think, and we see a lot of good example of that, particularly in the emerging, like Southeast Asia and other markets, actually, where the banks and operators is actually working together, or intend to work together, actually.
And from Southeast Asia to Latin America, Ericsson remains at the forefront of researching specific cultural trends. For the latter, it would seem the greatest hurdle to overcome relates to its cachonomy culture. So how does Lars see the balance between technology and culture emerging, and how much of a shift in consumer psychology needs to prevail?
You're right. I mean, we have done studies in some regions, Latin America and Africa, that we have published. And particularly in Latin America, as you say, it's a very cash-driven market. I think it's 70 or 80% is actually cash-driven. And there is a reason for that, of course. It's a lot of thoughts. Why is it that way? And I don't think Ericsson is the single company that can change that. but one particular thing that we definitely can impact, I think, as we go along here, is to work with the different key players and the key stakeholders in the ecosystems. Government is an example. Operator is an example. To ensure that there is enough of trust actually in the network itself, if it is the entire ecosystems actually. So we as a consumer trust actually to do financial services in that network. So there is pretty complex say environment, a lot of conditions around it that must be addressed actually. But once again, I think the only way to do it is to have a dialogue with the key players in these ecosystems and share the vision. And I think based on the dialogue we've had so far with some of them, I'm very happy to say that there is clear ambitions, clear visions. I think once again, pretty clear view as well, what is the top three, top five key things that must be in place in order to achieve that vision that they have 5 years down the road.
But with traditional competitors needing to function as partners within the ecosystem, that good environment is proving anything but easy to induce. So what position does Ericsson see itself holding within the fluid dynamics of tomorrow's mCommerce arena?
Let me start with this and say here that Ericsson is not a consumer company. We don't carry the services to end users. Our role is actually to enable our partners out there with technology, products and services, like banks or any kind of financial institutions. So that is our business and the business model. And of course, we do that on a global scale. We have, of course, a couple of products and solutions in the particular area of mCommerce. On a broader scale, Ericsson have had a significant of solution and products as well that we take into account case by case. On top of that, we then work also with, let's say, different kind of initiatives in the standardization, with the standardization bodies. We also work with other big global companies, might be in the banking or in the card industry or in the remittance industry, where we share the ambition and vision that we have, and we think how what we would like to do, and try to invite them actually to the initiatives that we have and we foresee. And happy to say that we have been pretty successful so far, actually, work with some of these companies on a global basis as well. So there we are a facilitator and actually drive a little bit of the global kind of initiatives. I can also say that some of that these initiatives has also been discussed like in the World Economic Forum or under the UN umbrella, etc., who have different kind of initiatives. So there we also playing a role. So it's both on the upper level, and then of course we provide product, technology and services to our potential partners.
Provision is quite clearly a key component for the Swedish telco giant. But how do they envision impacting the lives of those working and living within the African marketplace? I wrapped up by asking Lars where his biggest challenges are likely to come from over the next 12 months.
Some of these markets has developed very rapidly. There is big differences between the countries in Africa itself. And some of them are still in early stage, some of them is very advanced. We foresee actually, we have a very good presence, and we have also other kind of subsystems within Ericsson, for example, in the charging systems or prepaid systems in that region, significant. So hundreds of millions of subscribers are actually in the Ericsson systems, and what we see we will do is actually enable these systems as well with, call it, wallet solutions or mobile wallets, meaning that different kind of services could actually be combined, more classic kind of telco services, text or SMS or whatever, and then you attach actually mobile financial services into that. That gives also the operators a better compelling story and more value add to their installed base and consumers, so you bring loyalty. So from a consumer perspective, that is something, of course, that is very compelling, interesting for the operator, of course, it support their strategy and business going forward. So that kind of solutions we have been promoting, we start to see now that during the coming 12 months, it will start to reach the market. And of course, once again, we have for that, of course, as we can support our customers and business out there and see the business growing. So particularly Africa, I would like to say, is a market that is well positioned for that.
For more fantastic interviews directly related to your business, be sure to explore Meet the Boss TV.